So quickly going to pull out some of some of the elements of this story. So it's a fabulous film. It's just come out on Netflix, so I'm going over it again. Won the Academy Award in 1963. It came out in 1962. Fabulous movie, stood the test of time, a bit like The Godfather. An amazing, amazing story. At 3.5 hours long, maybe even a bit longer, 3 hours 40 minutes, which shows that the pacing, the journey, that length is irrelevant. It's the journey and the pacing. It's all proportional, and actually quite a simple, straightforward rollout and structure. Anyway, I'll go into that in a second. Let's go over basic story architecture first. Same thing we do with all the videos. So when you first start writing and filmmaking, you have a linear perspective in that sense. Pretty soon, you'll realize that both the beginning and the ending are the same, which is why we demonstrate story structure via a loop. We identify the classic beginning and ending as a state of perfection, which is lost, becomes a state of imperfection, the loss phase and the limitations phase, and the process of returning to it is undergone. So this is terminology that describes a number of things that you'll be familiar with, perhaps. So in essence, it's paradise becomes paradise lost. You have a whole family that becomes broken. You have wholeness here. You have unwholeness here. You have faith. You lose your faith here. You have belief. You lose your belief here. So, in essence, various aspects of wholeness, completeness, paradise lost, or paradise becomes paradise lost. And the idea is to come back around and return to it. So, we can start there, or start there, or somewhere in between. If you do that, the events they tend to be referenced at later stages. Most stories, such as this one, end with some form of state of perfection. If you don't want to do that, if you want to end with imperfection or some combination, that's almost irrelevant. The process is always the same. So you're always going to have transformation, change, metamorphosis, transmogrification, the various arcs, psychological journey. You're going to have physical journey, and you're always moving through new worlds, which really are physical manifestations of new psychological states and new versions of the self. Working your way around the cycle involves jumping through lots of hoops. Each hoop has its own set of sub-stages, which in essence are functions which may be performed, messages which may be communicated. They tell you what tangibles or intangibles you're going in there to acquire, what symbolism to insert, and so on. So for example, if that is the ordinary world, we know it's a state of protection, repression, fear of exit, etc. So those stages show you how to construct those sequences. When you're here, you're not able to return. You have to go forward, come all the way around until you're ready to return. So that's basic story architecture. It's the fundamental framework that all successful stories are based around. And I go over that in great detail. The 2100 stage of journey, transformation, movement through new worlds and states, which you can purchase at the website. So that's basic story architecture. So we know now there's a lot more to that than a simple loop or circle would suggest. So Lawrence of Arabia, fantastic movie. I'm going to split it into two halves, which in essence is how it is structured. So you're coming into it, and then the end of the first half, in essence, you're coming out of the road of trials, and what we've done is we've conquered Aqaba. And you can see here we've got Lawrence. So really, Paradise Lost, in essence, that is referenced in the Arab tribes. That, in one way that it's referenced, is that you've got Arab tribes that are all disunited. And as Lawrence says to Ali, that they'll always be, as long as they're disunited, they will be greedy, barbarous, etc. I can't remember the exact phrasing. So they're disunited, and so one of the things that Lawrence is trying to do there is trying to bring it back round and bring them and make them united. So when we start off, we see him in the ordinary self, in an ordinary world. He's in Cairo. He's a lowly officer. And by the time he's come back round and he's exited there, he's a celebrity. He comes back to the British, and he speaks to Allenby, and when Allenby is done with him and Dryden are done with him, then he's given a big round of applause. So you've got him arcing up there, and then that arc then proceeds when we have our Chicago Tribune photographer arrive and in essence makes him a global superstar. So there's one aspect of the arc there. So in essence, he is a chosen one on some respects. Dryden chooses him. Dryden is the herald. In his ordinary lowly state, he has an interest in the Arab world. Dryden, the herald, spots that and asks him to go forward onto the journey. And then we've got various people holding that journey back, just functional characters. They can't see why he would be the one, but of course, some see what others do not see. So he's off. One of the ideas underpinning it is him holding the matchstick until it burns out. So the idea around pain here, which comes into play in the near-death experience where he's beaten and allegedly raped. He's off on the journey, so we leave at the edge of the ordinary world, then we are going, and we've got a task there. We've got a task or an initial quest. You can call it quest one, and that will stage gate the journey forward in some ways. Edge of the ordinary world leaves the comfort and protection of the British, joins his guide on his way to King Faisal. And again, he's a fish out of water here, tries to belong, tries to be a Bedouin, takes his initial steps there. You've got a supernatural aid, him meeting Ali, and then again, the issues around disunity. So you've got Ali shooting another Bedouin who used the well. So then we come into the first threshold. This is King Faisal's world. It's a new world. You don't belong here. You're a stranger here. You're almost invisible here at the beginning. And you've got a choice to make. So this is when we meet Brighton. Brighton says, look, we've got an official British line. You're going to stick to that. And then you've got the Arab line. Ultimately, what you're going to have to do is make a choice. And he does make a choice here, and especially after the atonement and the apotheosis and the boon. In fact, the boon is part of the choice, where he tells Allenby that he's going to give them Damascus, and he's doing it for the Arabs. And he goes against the British, which is why in Act 3 you have it rolling out the way it does. So here, at the beginning of the first threshold, what we need is a miracle, and that in essence is your second quest or your second task. Boom, 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 boom. You've got to take Aqaba. There is the belly of the whale functions, how dangerous it is, etc. and so forth. And then, in essence, the road of trials through the desert, through the sun's anvil, until you conquer Aqaba and he becomes a celebrity. And also the meeting of Auda, in other words, another tribe, the Hawitak, and them all coming together. So then you've got that second part, task completed, that second quest, if you like, completed, you've got him uniting tribes that are enemies and uniting against the Turks. So that in essence is the first part, and that is takes you up to the intermission. And again, he's a celebrity to both worlds. He's a celebrity to the British here, and he's a celebrity to the Arabs, who think at this stage that he's perfect. Then we're going through the second part, in essence, where Again, you can subdivide it again. So here he starts off believing he's an extraordinary man. We've got our reporter who makes him a superstar, and then he goes into his near-death experience. He's captured by the Turks and beaten and allegedly raped. And he comes out of it believing that he's an ordinary man. So going down, we're arcing down from extraordinary down to ordinary. What else happens there? Yeah, I mean, here you had all the tribes uniting. Here we have detachment. So we've got Auda is leaving because the reason is almost inconsequential, because it's the wrong season and he's gotten what he wants, and now he's going. He's found something honorable. He loses Faraj. All his men disappear, and he's basically arcing down again, which is the reverse of what's been happening here. So then he goes from believing he's extraordinary, godlike, in fact, one of the lines is, why not Moses did, and then to believing he's ordinary, wants to go back and just be ordinary again, an ordinary soldier. Doesn't really belong here, and then is pushed into the third act back because Allenby has his big push. Believing he's extraordinary and believing the impossible is possible, and he makes his choice and he chooses the Arabs, which is why when he gets to Damascus, he does it for the Arabs. Also, what we have here is this hatred for the Turks that escalates gradually, incrementally evolves, and then that's let go of once he sees what's happened in the Arab hospital. So he makes his choice. He creates the beginnings of a state, as was said actually in the ordinary world. I may not be able to fiddle, but I can make a great state out of a small city. That's in essence what he does here. And then politics comes into play, and you end up having, in essence, at that time, a British infrastructure with an Arab flag. Anyway, yeah, great movie. You can see this gets complicated. I mean, this all involves lots of workshop sessions, but you can see that the process is followed. You can see the journey is undertaken, and you can see the stages. You can see how it's cut up and how it's rolled out. Again, if you want a detailed deconstruction of this story, you can order it off the website. But once again, this whole process of journey, change, transformation, movement through new world and states, you can purchase off the in the 2100 stage of journey, transformation, movement through new worlds and states. You can purchase that off the website.